On behalf of the Doran Annual Lecture Committee, my name is Guy Steklov, and on behalf of the committee, which includes Professors Barbara Okun and Professor Guy Alpaz, I'd like to welcome you to the 9th Annual Doran Lecture on Population Resources and Development. I'd like to give special thanks to the local program for helping to sponsor and organize the event, particularly the Go. Before presenting the speaker, I'm going to ask Alan Doran, son of David Benjamin Doran, whose generous contribution made this series possible, come say a few words. So thank you.
Well, good evening, everyone. I'm very pleased to be here. This is, as Guy said, this is the 9th lecture, and I've managed to be here in person for all 9 so far. Hopefully, we'll continue. Josh is actually the first of the lecturers that I have met before he or she has come to Jerusalem. And in fact, we met in Oxford, and we were introduced by a mutual friend, Kate Rayworth, who some of you may have heard of with the donut economics, which is another approach to some of the issues that I think Josh will be talking about inequity and finiteness on our planet Earth. I always think that economics, I was thinking about this, what should I say, that it's of reasonable interest without blathering on too much, but economics is a discipline which underlies so much of decision making in so many fields all around the Earth. And the paradox is that economics, in my view, is a discipline in crisis, and it has been for a long time. And I think it's a very odd situation. The discipline that we rely on most is the one that arguably has got the biggest crisis. So I'll leave that remark with you. So,
and I would second that remark.
So this is a really important talk for us. It's the 9th talk. That's not what makes it important. But this talk has actually been in, it's been almost happening since the whole series began. From the beginning, Alan was speaking about ecological economics and had mentioned the importance of us becoming familiar with some of the works of Herman Daly and some other people in the field. And somehow we've continued. We've had a lot of really interesting talks. Some of them have made us not sleep at night. We've heard, you know, polar contrasts between some alarmist type ecological modeling and then some much more optimistic neoclassical type approaches to some of these same issues relating to resources, population, and development. But today we get to hear something really different, which is the purpose of the series. And we're going to hear how ecological economists look at some of these same issues that we've heard about before. And we're very, very fortunate today to get to hear Professor Joshua Farley. Professor Joshua Farley is the professor in community development and applied economics and public administration at the University of Vermont. He holds degrees in biology, economics, and international affairs. His contributions focus on understanding what sort of mechanisms are required to alter the economy so that it functions both within its own biophysical limits as well as so that it is responsive to both ethical and social constraints and interests. He has a really impressive and diverse CV. On the one hand, he has a classical academic CV, long list of publications in good places, lots of presentations, sort of things we all strive for. He's on a number of editorial boards of journals that are central in the field. But he's also collaborated with some of the really key founders of this entire field of ecological economics, such as Herman Daly and Frank Costanza. Right. And we're very, very lucky to have him here and very excited to hear your talk. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. All right. So, I really want to talk about this idea that, we have economics for a finite planet. Mainstream economists believe the major goal of an economic system is to grow, and to grow indefinitely, to grow forever. So they have a system based on exponential growth. Ecological economists generally believe that no subsystem can grow indefinitely as part of a finite system. And so I want to talk about some of these issues about the finite. Don't know why that did that. Let me just turn that thing off. Get back to here. I don't know why. There we go. So I want to talk about the problems with a finite planet, and this problem that people have been paying a lot of attention to, this growing inequality. And I want to make the case, actually, that...
I'm sorry to interrupt. Could you just talk a little
slower?
Yes.
Okay.
Much.
Sorry. That's one of my problems. I also want to talk about why our current market economic system fails miserably when we have growing inequality. So to begin with, I want to make the case that economic systems continually evolve and always have evolved. And if you go back for most of human history, you know, a couple hundred thousand years, we were hunter-gatherers. And as hunter-gatherers, we were quite nomadic. There's a book on hunter-gatherer economies called Limited Wants, Unlimited Means. And the idea is people accumulated very little. They had the resources available to get what they needed to meet their basic needs. And they were nomadic, traveled a lot. And if you had to, you're going after plants and animals that move. You use the plants in one area, you've got to go somewhere else. You can eat the animals in one area, you've got to follow the herds. That meant people were highly mobile, and it's very well established that they accumulated very little. And when you gave hunter-gatherer things, I think Darwin talks about giving some hunter-gatherer tribes beautiful wool blankets. They loved them. They slept in them. As soon as they moved on, they left them behind. And the idea, wait, tell us in economics that humans are insatiable. We always want to accumulate more and more and more. That's human nature. I want to point out for 200,000 years, that was impossible. If you accumulated more than you could carry, you would starve to death. So just that quickly about hunter-gatherer kind of stuff. But then, 11,400 years ago, suddenly the climate got freakishly stable. And we moved into what's called the Holocene epoch. It's a geological epoch. And we had, and around the world, you know, so 50,000 years ago, we emerged out of Africa, we spread around the planet, cultures not in contact with each other at all, using very simple Stone Age technologies until the climate became stable. And then around the world, in many different places, in a short period of time, they all developed agriculture, which requires a stable climate. So I want to stress that our climates and environments have a huge impact on what we do. But once you got an agricultural economy, suddenly property rights are important. Division of labor becomes important. You develop these political hierarchies. So the Europeans, to give an example, had essentially been separated from the indigenous American populations for 50,000 years. When they arrived in Mexico, they recognized the economic system, the political system, the religious system, all of these things that had appeared since the Holocene appeared very similar around the world. Some of the things you get is increasing population density. With increasing population density, ideas circulate, are discussed, can improve and grow. And there's this idea that if you have more population density, knowledge can improve very quickly, and you get faster and faster rates of change. So we went through a period where rates of change, every 10,000 years, you might get a new technology. Now rates of change were accelerating rapidly, still too slow to witness within a single generation. But then we came upon the industrial economics, which is they now talk about changing our geological epoch from Holocene to Anthropocene, where humans have become the driving force on our planet, changing the geochemical systems, having a greater effect on our planets than anything else, than any other natural system. And this is the dawn of fossil fuels. So the fossil fuel economy and the capitalist economy emerged at exactly the same time. For the first time, we didn't depend on flows of solar energy. We could depend on stored energy, which we could extract and use as fast as we want. Solar energy, you use at the rate it comes. We have no control. Fossil fuels, we consume at the rate we choose. And we use those fossil fuels to have access to a huge number of other non-renewable resources. So suddenly we went from renewable flows to non-renewable stocks. We developed an economic system based on competitive self-interest, this capitalism, with the goal of ever-increasing economic growth. And then around 1950, we had what's called this great acceleration, where suddenly population growth skyrocketed, resource growth skyrocketed, economic output skyrocketed, just this incredible exponential growth from 1950 on that we're still somewhat in the middle of. And I would actually argue that we're now, we've had another dramatic shift in our economy just in recent years. So when I studied economics, the average stock was held for about seven and a half years. And when you did international exchange of money, you would buy a currency to buy real goods and services. Now, the average stock is held for about 30 seconds. Because, you know, it's this lightning quick change. You're not buying a stock because you're investing in something, you're speculating. And international currencies, the exchange in international currencies is $5.3 trillion a day, which is probably 25 times the size of the global economy. And those currencies are held on average for 22 seconds. So it's this very speculative economy. We learn in economics that when a resource becomes scarce, the price goes up. When the price goes up, people demand less. They consume less. And also there's incentive to supply more. But in a financial economy, a speculation economy, the price of something goes up, the price of land goes up, speculators suddenly demand more with the expectation the price will increase more, or the price of a currency goes up, or the price of, you know, food, oil, anything. So what we have a system that mainstream economics is modeled as an equilibrium system where price increases always reduce demand, increase supply, driving the system to equilibrium. Now we have a system where an increasing price attracts a huge amount of speculative demand, which increases the price, which attracts more speculative demand. So the point I want to make is that this is a fundamentally different system than we used to have. Another point I want to make is that we have these people, it used to be, you know, when I studied economics, they told us that the stock market gave people a chance to invest their money in firms, created money for corporations to invest in real production of goods and services, created jobs, all this wonderful stuff. Now, the vast majority of stock market investments are buying existing stocks. You know, Apple, Exxon, all these firms, Google, they're buying back their own stocks. This is not creating money to invest in new activities. It's driving up the value of existing assets. And what we're seeing is through this financial system where the speculators produce nothing, get fabulously rich doing it. If they're not increasing the quantity of goods and services, but they're increasing their entitlement to consuming them, it's a system that redistributes wealth to the already wealthy and without stimulating economic production. So that's where we are now, I would argue. What we need to do is develop a new economy based on these new constraints. As a result of the Anthropocene, the resources that are most constraining, what we need, it's, we don't need bigger houses, bigger cars, bigger TVs. We need stable climates. We need water purification. We need oceanic fisheries capable of reproducing themselves and sustaining this biomass that's in collapse. We need an economy that addresses the new emerging shortages of ecology, but also an economy based very much on information. A standard definition of economics is the allocation of scarce resources among alternative desirable ends. The idea about scarce is there's not enough to go around. Information is not scarce. If some of you hear this lecture, it doesn't leave any less information for others. If somebody uses a mathematical theorem, it doesn't leave any less mathematical knowledge for others. In fact, information improves through use. It's the opposite of scarce. We have an economy geared towards scarcity, and we have a incredibly important, essential resource, information, that improves through use. So I'm going to make the case that in our new economic system, we need degrowth. We need to shrink the physical size of the economy to respect ecological constraints, and we need ecological distribution to meet the needs of those who don't have enough to consume right now. And that to do this, I want to make the case not some kind of spiritual, like, touchy-feely case that we need cooperation and altruism, but I want to make the case that cooperation and altruism are essential to solve the problems we face because of the physical characteristics of those problems. So that's kind of what I want to focus on. And so that's economics as evolutionary system, but I also want to talk about economy as a physical system. So it's a basic law of physics. You can't make something from nothing. You also can't make nothing from something. The only something we have to make any economic product is the raw materials provided by our planet. You can't do work without energy. So anything we do requires energy. 86% of our energy is fossil fuels. And when we burn those fossil fuels, we don't lose the energy. We turn it into waste heat, waste particulate matter, and carbon dioxide. And so this is an inevitable process that, our economic system converts raw materials from nature into economic products and returns this waste to nature. And it's the second law of thermodynamics says that essentially the simple way to think about it is that disorder increases. We burn a barrel of oil, we don't lose energy, but it becomes disordered, useless energy. And this is just fundamental laws of physics we have to pay attention to. We also have to pay attention to the laws of ecology. So those raw materials we take from nature and convert into economic products, they alternatively serve as the structural building blocks of our ecosystems. And that structure generates function, and those functions are essential for human survival. The filtration of water, the balance of atmospheric gases, climate stability, the capacity of these ecosystems to, and the, all the raw material in them to reproduce. So when we remove that ecosystem structure, we lose those ecosystem functions, and those are essential to sustain humans and all other species. There is no species that can survive independent of those. And when we spew waste back into the system, we do the same thing. We destroy these ecosystem functions, often called ecosystem services, like climate stability. So it's an inevitable process of economic activity that we are degrading ecosystems and losing flows of benefits from those ecosystems that are essential to us. So we go then to the laws of economics. And the most basic thing we learn in economics, you keep doing something as long as the benefit of doing one more unit exceeds the cost. I keep buying slices of pizza as long as the pleasure I get from that pizza exceeds the cost. When it stops, when the pleasure stops being greater than the cost, I stop buying the pizza. And so this is a basic idea. In the last 100 years, this just shows here that the economy is a physical subsystem of a finite planet. Over the last 100 years, our human populations have quadrupled in size. Per capita consumption has increased 9 times. So we essentially have an economy that's 36 times larger than it was 100 years ago. It has not grown in some empty void. It has grown into a finite planet. And it, as it grows, it displaces those ecological functions we need to survive. And it reduces the flow of ecological benefits. What we want is some kind of welfare or well-being that's not a physical thing. There are people who, you know, once your basic needs are met, there are people who have very little and are very happy and are fulfilling lives, and people who are fabulously well-to-do and live in misery. So I show welfare to some extent is this separate psychic phenomena. But the basic point I want to show is that here, when our economy has expanded upon our finite ecosystem. 85% of oceanic fisheries are, fished at or beyond capacity. You know, waste flows of CO2 into the atmosphere exceed absorption capacities 10 times over. We're depleting this ecosystem. What we're doing is we have uneconomic growth. The cost, the ecological cost of economic growth now exceed the economic benefits. We are becoming worse off, not better off. And this is a basic principle in economics for individual consumption, but economists ignore it at the macro level. They assume there's no such thing as too much economic growth or that there are no costs at the economic growth. So we live on a finite planet. This is the figure from Kate Raworth that Alan talked about. So we have these societal challenges. So a recent study looked at planetary boundaries, and it said that there are these 9 boundaries. If our economic activities or human activities exceed those boundaries, there's this risk of a catastrophic collapse of our ecosystems and the capacity of those ecosystems to sustain human civilization. And biodiversity loss is considered the biggest one. The next one here is actually the nitrogen cycle. So it's where most nitrogen produced by the Haber-Bosch process, we're fertilizing our plants. But phosphorus is huge. Climate change is huge. Change in land use, global fresh water use, ozone depletion. There's a whole bunch of these. And we are threatening the capacity of our Earth system to sustain us into the future. I want to point out that most of these actually are targeted, most of these threats come from agriculture. You know, phosphorus, nitrogen, land use change, biodiversity loss. So we have this, agriculture is this huge threat. So we have these ecological threats. We surpass these things, our system could collapse. At the same time, this is, you can't see this very well, this is Kay Raworth and from Oxfam came up with this idea. She says there's basic human needs that aren't being met. So we have this, if we exceed these boundaries, we're doomed. But if we fail to supply these basic needs, then you're going to have misery, suffering, you're going to have, what we're saying is, we want to keep the economy from expanding so much it destroys basic systems, but if you have people who can't put food into their children's bellies, I mean, I would chop down the last tree, kill the last fish if it meant feeding my crying child. And you can't have sustainability at the ecological level if you haven't met people's basic needs at the social level. So this is what they call the sustainability donut. You can't exceed these ecological thresholds, but you've got to meet these basic needs, and we're not doing either. We have an economic system right now that doesn't meet basic needs. There's a billion people almost who fail to get enough food every day. And at the same time, our economic system is destroying global ecosystems. So we have this serious challenge. And what this means, again, we need just and sustainable growth. Sustainable growth to solve that problem, just distribution to solve this problem. So there's another way of looking at this, and as an economist, I'm going to show a little bit more the way economists look at it. Economists always have they have quantity supplied of something and the price. Price I'm showing here is marginal value, or in this case, the cost of supplying something. And a supply curve in economics is the marginal cost of supplying additional unit. As long as somebody will pay me more than it costs me to provide something, I'll provide it. And when the price of or my costs equal what I receive, I don't supply anymore because you have this idea of growing costs. So in this case, what I'm showing is using food production as an example, the supply curve, the cost of agriculture, you have to account for labor and capital, but you also have to account for biodiversity loss and nitrogen pollution and climate change. All those are real unavoidable costs of agriculture. And as these costs rise, we lose increasingly important ecological benefits. And the cost can increase very quickly. And what I'm showing here is one of these planetary boundaries. When we emit too much carbon dioxide and it destabilizes the atmosphere, we get runaway climate change, we can't produce food. This is an ecological collapse. So the costs become immeasurably high over here. And the trade-off here, you either get a system change or collapse when you pass those boundaries. In economics, we always talk about prices and costs, but price is immeasurable. If we're collapsing a system, there's no monetary value you can place on that. I mean, marginal analysis, which economics is based on, is no longer appropriate. If we ever pass one of these boundaries, what we have to do is somehow shrink our economy back to size before the collapse becomes irreversible and catastrophic. And I would argue this is very clearly where we are on several of these boundaries. You could also look at this, I showed that for food, but you could look at it as economic output as a whole for a fossil fuel-based economy. It takes energy to do work. Our energy is fossil fuels. And when we do that work, we are threatening those planetary boundaries. This was a journal, it was published in Nature, highly prestigious journal. It's a pretty solid piece of work. So we have these ecological thresholds in the economic supply curve. Economists look at supply and demand. So now I want to look at physiological boundaries, health thresholds, and the demand curve. So to keep this simple and easy to understand, focusing on essential resources, these are things we need. If we don't get enough, we die. Food, water, you got to have energy. These are things. I'm looking at food as the simplest one. And if this is per capita consumption of food, when you're consuming way out here, 3,750 calories a day like the United States or 3,500 like the other countries, the marginal value, the additional contribution to your well-being for more food is essentially zero, arguably negative. In fact, I would say it's negative, but people continue to do it. So you have this thing where your values here, where you've got a lot of calories you're consuming, your values are low and stable. If I consume, 500 more or 500 less calories, it doesn't matter that much. My trade-offs are relatively unimportant. If I have to consume less food to buy something else, I'm not sacrificing much. I'm not sacrificing my health or anything else. So we have these relatively unimportant trade-offs. Here, though, now you're going to, 2,500 calories per day might be like food security. If you're in this range between 1,500 and 2,500, and these are actually, I won't go through the details, these are countries, I estimated this curve based on real data, but these countries here that aren't consuming enough, that they're consuming, 1,700 calories a day, If you give up food, you're not going to have energy to work hard. Your immune system's going to be weaker. If your kids don't get that food, their development is less complete. So you have really serious costs as your quantity goes down. You're really giving up serious sacrifices. And there's a physiological threshold in this case, is the minimum amount of food you need to survive. If you fall below this threshold for an extended period, you die. Again, marginal analysis, which economics is based on, becomes irrelevant because it's a non-marginal change. Less food means I die. That's non-marginal change. So again, it's this, it's the idea that, you know, we have to stay above this. This is an unacceptable physiological threshold that we can't cross. And the way you could look at this, putting these things together, the challenge we face, right now we already saw from that planetary boundaries that our nitrogen emissions, our phosphorus emissions, our carbon dioxide emissions are threatening these planetary boundaries. The ecological costs of economic activity are unacceptably high. At the same time, we have almost 1 billion malnourished people, about 800 million malnourished people. For them, the marginal benefits of more food are immeasurably high. So we're in this situation where the ecological costs already are too high. The economic benefits of more consumption are measurably high for those who don't have enough. We have supply and demand curves that don't intersect. I use here throughput. Mainstream economists talk about output, or you know, what you've produced. Ecological economists say every act of production also generates a flow of waste. So we have to account for the raw material resources in, what we produce, and the waste flow out. So instead of just quantity, I'm talking about throughput, acknowledging that all economic activity transforms raw materials from nature into waste matter. And so this is the challenge we face. How do we somehow either shift, you know, either produce more with doing less harm, or to fulfill people's basic needs while with lower total levels of output. So this is what we want to do. And what I want to look at, so how does the market say we should focus on this? So I want to look at market solutions to this problem. And to be honest, mainstream market economists won't accept this analysis anyway. They don't really believe in planetary boundaries. They typically believe that technology will step in and save the day. And I'll explain a little bit more, they don't worry too much about the poor not getting enough to eat. So market solutions, though, the idea is that markets are based on competition, self-interest, and choice. I get to choose whatever I want to do. If I see that resource is scarce, so the price is going up, I can choose to produce that, and that's going to raise the quantity, and I'm going to compete with others, which is going to force me to be efficient, and I'm acting only in my self-interest, but everybody acting in their self-interest leads to the greatest good for the greatest number, and we allow individuals to satisfy their own preferences. So mainstream economists say we've got to only rely on individuals satisfying their own preferences, and only they know what they are. We have this problem, though, of all these ecological costs that when you drive a car and you spew out CO2, or when Exxon, drills oil, they don't pay for those extra costs. Or when farmers put too much nitrogen in the soils and it causes dead zones, they don't pay those costs. Those are called externalities. They're not part of the economic framework. So economists say we need to internalize those externalities. We essentially have some way of putting a price on those, feeding it back into the market economy. So the idea is that if we put a price on these ecological costs, feed it back into the market, it's going to create incentives. So suddenly I have to pay when I'm spewing out CO2. I'm going to develop alternative energy. Or I'll use my car more efficiently, or I'll develop alternative energy. So we internalize externalities. So the one thing to think about here, this is the main framework for economists to think about these ecological problems, they're externalities. They are outside, explicitly outside of our economic framework. But if climate change and biodiversity loss and, you know, depletion of natural resources are among the most serious threats we face, and you say they're outside of your economic framework, perhaps your economic framework is fundamentally flawed. So that's one way to think about this. But what economists do, they say we want preference satisfaction. What they fail to mention is it's really preferences weighted by purchasing power. It has to do with how much money I have. And to give an example of what this means, so Americans, we spend about 6% of our food our income on food for home consumption. So about 1% of our income is spent on raw food, like raw grain. So the price of wheat goes way up, you know, it has very little impact on us because that's raw food. Many Africans, like Tanzanians, spend up to 75% of their income on food for take-home consumption. Maybe 50% of that is like raw grain. So what's going to happen when prices double? When prices double, and give a real life. So what happened to the price of wheat in 2007 to 2008? Anybody know? Any clues what happened to the price of wheat?
$100 per 100 kilos.
But what kind of price increase was that? So the price of wheat, price of basic grains tripled, or doubled. Price of wheat actually tripled at one point. And so how many of you, when that price signal, huge price signal, tripling of the price of wheat, how many ate less bread? Nobody in the wealthy nations ate less bread. In fact, we didn't even notice. Nobody even noticed. But what happened in Africa, what happened in the Arab countries, the Arab Spring, food prices skyrocketed, people rioted, people overthrew governments, huge economic political disruption. So economists tell us that the magic of the market allocates resources to those who value them the most. And we assume what that means is they're going to allocate the food to the starving individual. What they do is they allocate resources to those who value them the most in terms of how much they're willing to pay. And Americans, when you buy a $2 loaf of bread, you're paying 10 cents for the wheat. When the price of wheat triples, you're now paying $2.20 for that loaf of bread. Americans didn't notice. Our consumption of wheat actually increased. It was only the poor countries that had to slash their consumption. So the economists tell us that markets magically allocate resources to whoever values them the most. But if you believe that the marginal utility or the marginal value of food is greater for an overfed American than a destitute woman trying to feed her kids so they mature normally, that's a pretty bizarre definition. What the market system preferences, you know, preferences are prioritized over physiological need. Most textbooks actually say there's no difference between wants and needs. So we have this system that kind of allocates resources perversely. So what's this look like? So I showed you before, I said this was the physiological demand curve. Now I'm just relabeled it the market demand curve. And instead of calories per person, you know, one person's consumption of calories, you can look at this as global production of food in calories per person per day. And what happens now is when we're producing, as we are today, about 2,700 calories per person per day, most poor people can afford food. And so now we're looking at the price. So I've changed that to price instead of marginal value. Most poor people can afford food when we're producing that much. But as the quantity falls a little bit, and this is something to think about. I don't know how many of you have traveled to other countries or dealt with food change. You go to a country where food costs half as much, you're probably going to eat the same. You go to a country where food costs twice as much, you're probably going to eat the same. We have inelastic demand for food. Those who can maintain their consumption of food regardless of the cost. What that means is small decreases in food supply lead to skyrocketing food costs. If food production goes down a little bit, well, the middle class, you know, we see a tripling of the price of wheat. Middle class can still eat. Poor don't eat anymore. So the poor drop off the demand curve, essentially. And then if prices get really high, if we get a big decrease in food production, then, you know, only the rich will eat and the middle class will go hungry. We haven't gotten there yet. But that's what markets do. They allocate resources to the individual willing to pay the most. So now we look at the same thing, markets in action. So first of all, how do markets treat this ecological cost of the supply curve? We ignore them. We don't force people to pay the ecological cost. So we ignore that, and then we have the supply curve that only counts for labor and capital. And what do they think about the demand for the poor? We ignore that too. We just don't pay attention to that. So our market solution is essentially to ignore the needs of the poor and to ignore ecological costs. And that's how the market economy is functioning. So why are markets unsuitable for solving these problems? And here's where I get to the physical characteristics of resources. So this isn't ideology. This is a scientific approach to understanding these resources. So for a market to work, you need to be able to own a resource. So if a resource is excludable, it means I can keep others from using it unless I want them to use it. Non-excludable means I can't do that. If you could walk into a store and the stuff in a store was non-excludable, you could take anything you wanted, nobody could stop you from doing it, nobody would have a store. The market only works when resources are excludable. But a lot of ecosystem, ecological benefits are inherently non-excludable. So, well, often we lack laws or institutions. So oceanic fisheries, we could make them excludable. But last year, we decided that, tried to get together and debate whether or not to fish bluefin tuna into extinction. Couldn't come to agreement. Basically, we decided we're going to fish them into extinction. And we've done that for most of our oceanic fisheries. But we could come up with ideas. We could come up with a law that says you're not allowed just to spew your CO2 into the atmosphere. We could make it excludable. You can't do that unless you pay, or you can't do that unless you have a permit. We could create laws that make that happen. We haven't done it, but we could. Same with population growth. We could have rules that keep people from having as many kids as they want. But there's no laws or institutions that do that. So these things are non-excludable, and if they're non-excludable, anybody who wants can take them, and they're going to go overfish. So if I could, you know, I could catch that bluefin tuna, I know if I take that pregnant female, there's not going to be any enough next year, but if I don't take it, somebody else will take it. And I don't know if you guys know, like, I think the top price for a bluefin tuna was $1.2 million for one fish. You know, $100,000 for a fish is no big deal. So, you know, there's this big thing. If there's no laws to protect it, people take it. People, you know, there's nothing prevents me from spewing my waste in the atmosphere. I do that. I fish out the fish. So the market doesn't work because there's no property rights. Some things are inherently non-excludable. Climate regulation. How can I say, you know, we're going to have a stable climate, but only for those who pay for it? Or it's going to be, you know, for some, not for others. By its physical nature, you can't have everybody has the same level of climate regulation. Or if you look at New Orleans, where they got rid of the sandbars and the wetlands that protected the city from storm surges, everybody has that protection or nobody has it. It's impossible to have individual ownership. It strikes me, if it's impossible to have individual ownership, then only collective ownership is possible. So another big issue, though, so this is one thing: you can't have markets when resources aren't owned. Another big issue is that when resources are non-rival, a rival resource, my use leaves less for others. I drink this water, there's less for you. I sit in that chair, somebody else can't sit in it. A non-rival resource means I can use it and it doesn't leave any less for you. Information's the classic example, but things like, you know, the protection from UV radiation, or, you know, clean air, or lots of uses of water, my use doesn't leave less for anybody else. I'm actually mostly interested in information because I do think we need new technology to solve problems. And green technology, so markets don't work for these resources. And if you think about it, let me say I develop a clean alternative to fossil fuel energy, and it's cheap, decentralized, clean, non-polluting, and I put a patent on it. And if I put a patent on it, I can sell it at an astronomically high price. I sell it at an astronomically high price, lots of people can't afford to buy it. They're not going to use it. They're going to continue to burn coal. You know, maybe it'll be too expensive for China and India. They'll continue to burn coal. We'll get runaway climate change. And that's just plain stupid, because if they did use it, if we gave those green technologies for them to use, their brilliant scientists would make those technologies better, and we'd get back something better than we gave. And if they used those, we'd have a cleaner environment. So putting a market on these things, and this is a physical characteristic. Whether a resource is depleted by use or not is a physical characteristic. It's, you know, not ideology. And if you put a price on something that's not scarce, because my use doesn't leave less for others, that creates artificial scarcity, and we have less of it. So in these things, the optimal price is zero, and we really don't want markets dealing with those things. Another big issue, and so again, if we don't want markets to do it, we need those green technologies. If we leave the private sector to develop them, they're going to patent it, they're going to ration access, we'll have less use. So again, we need collective provision with no ownership. That's the optimal, that's the way we get most benefit from it. Another big issue why markets fail is essential resources I talked about. One thing is, when the price of food goes up, my demand doesn't go down because I die if I don't get it, so it's insensitive to price. That doesn't work. And that with gross inequality, the preferences of the rich trump the needs of the poor. So these are things why markets simply can't work. And actually, I totally lost. What time did I actually start talking, just to know?
You have about 10, 15 minutes.
Okay. So I'm going to go. So now I'm going to actually switch gears a little bit, but I think I can pull this off. So there's this type of problem called a prisoner's dilemma. And most of you probably have heard of it. If you haven't, but a prisoner's dilemma, I'm not going to go through the whole etymology of it, but the situation is one in which no matter, I have a choice of cooperating with everybody else and essentially putting the group ahead of the individual, or defecting and putting the individual ahead of the group. So with climate change, if we all cooperated and reduced our emissions, we could stave off global climate change and we'd all benefit. But if everybody else in the world is going to do that, you know, whether I do it or not doesn't matter. I'll get all the benefits of using fossil fuels and all you guys reduce, so I'm gonna free ride on your efforts. So if everybody else does it, no need for me to. If none of you do it, then I'd be stupid too. So the classic prisoner's dilemma is, no matter if you have a choice between cooperating or defecting, being selfish. If everybody cooperates as an individual, I'm better off defecting. If nobody cooperates as an individual, I'm certainly better off not cooperating. Regardless of what everybody else does, if I'm a rational, self-interested individual, I'm not going to cooperate. And then people thinking like that, we end up with the system going to hell. So population growth is one of these things. I'm the fourth kid, so I'm speaking a little hypocritically here. But if everybody has as many babies as they want, you get all the pleasure of having babies, but then the population gets too big and we get, global crisis because we don't have enough resources. And things like, I want to go kind of quick, so I'm not going to go through these things in great detail. Information in the, looking at this innovation in the information age with these green technologies I talked about, if everybody pitched in, all the scientists pitched in, or all the countries pitched in, funded these research to develop these green technologies we desperately need, if everybody pitched in, we're really well off. But if everybody else pitches in, I'm better off not pitching in and just using the technology anyway. If nobody else pitches in, I'm stupid to pitch in on my own. So we don't get these green technologies. The same as natural resource depletion. If everybody stopped fishing the bluefin tuna, we're all better off. But if everybody else stops, I'm going to get that bluefin tuna that sells for $1 million, and I get all the benefit myself. So there's all these problems, and across many, many disciplines, economics, political science, all sorts of disciplines, they recognize there are no competitive, self-interested solutions to prisoners' dilemmas. Cooperation is the only possible type of solution. And in my view, this requires collective ownership and collective production and protection. And my view is the most serious crises we face are climate change, population growth, natural resource depletion, and an inability to develop technologies that don't wipe people out. So this is the problem we face. How do we, we need to have cooperation. Mainstream economists say that everybody is inherently, self-interested and acts in their self-interest, incapable of cooperation. For a long time, evolutionists said the same thing. So, can people cooperate? I think it's a stupid question, personally. One thing, if I had more time, I would ask, I would take more time to do this, but I'll just, normally in classes, I ask students to give me five characteristics of an evil person and five characteristics of a good person. And I've done this in different countries, in different, age groups, in different cultures. And what inevitably comes out, an evil person is the one who puts the individual ahead of the group. Screw the other guy, I want it for me. The good person puts the group ahead of the individual. And I'm going to be, and I believe that's a characteristic of morality in almost any culture. What the group is could be very different. Taliban might say, well, my group is male Taliban, but I put that group ahead of the individual. Or a Baha'i might say, my group is the whole world. But the definition of a group really matters. So there's this idea. So I think it would be pretty bizarre that a species would define itself as evil, because mainstream economists say that we are rational, self-interested, always put the individual ahead of the group, and that leads to the greatest good for the greatest number. I think there's very little evidence of that. So really quickly, I'm very interested in this evolution of cooperation, and there's been a major change lately in how we view evolution. And there's this new approach, and Darwin recognized this. It was later rejected. There's this idea of multi-level selection. Darwin said it's obvious that the group with the most altruistic individuals in it, the most cooperative individuals, will be able to solve problems that require cooperation. It's going to outcompete other groups. But within the group, so you have this cooperative group that's outcompeting others, the individual that is the most selfish will outcompete other individuals. So you have these dual pressures. One example, there's this, there's a million different examples, but there's a bacteria called called Pseudomonas fluorescens. I think it's a bacteria, but I'm not quite sure. And you put it in a situation where it needs oxygen and it needs food, and they're all in this, this competitive flask. You can just do it on your desktop. And the Pseudomonas fluorescens has a variation called the wrinkly spreader. And it creates this film that locks them all together, and they float on the top, and they get oxygen, they get food, and outcompetes other ones that don't cooperate. Within that group, however, the ones that are selfish don't produce the film, subsist on the film of the others, out, they can produce more offspring because they're not putting energy into the film. But when the population of those gets too large, the colony of Pseudomonas fluorescens falls to the bottom and goes extinct. So you have a mechanism easily shown where you have dual forces and that humans evolved this way, where the most cooperative groups outcompeted other groups, but the selfish individual outcompeted others. So we have this situation in which we have an incredible plasticity, an ability to cooperate or an ability to defect, and a broad distribution. And these things are super interesting. I'm not going to go into it because I don't have time. But I want to say that a lot of species, like Pseudomonas fluorescens, depends only on genetics. We rely on culture as well. And it's hard to change ourselves genetically, but we can create institutions that lead a group of largely selfish people to cooperate, or a largely cooperative group of people to be selfish. And one example of this, I'm just going to give a simple example, is there's this public good game. I give everybody in this room $50. And I tell you, you can give me back as much of that as you want. It's going to go into a common pool. I'm going to double it and redistribute it equally to everybody, regardless of how much you pitched in. And so if every one of you pitched in $50, I give you $50, you all threw it back into the common pool, it double, you'd each get 100. So everybody does that. But as an individual, you can think, okay, let me see. If everybody else puts their $50 in, it's going to be doubled, and I'll get back almost 100. So if I keep my $50, I'll have 150. If nobody else puts their money in, I'd be an idiot to put my money in. So no matter what everybody else does, I'm better off being selfish. If you play this game, you keep playing the game, and what's going to happen is some people are going to be very generous. They're going to be on the, you know, the very generous side of the pro-social curve, and they're going to throw it all in, and other people are going to be Machiavellian or economists, and they're going to keep money for themselves. And you play this round, and the people who put in a lot are going to say, boy, I put in way more than my share. Next time, I'm going to cut my donation to the average. But you keep playing that game, and people keep cutting their donations to the average. You end up with nobody donating, everybody getting only $50. And this is that kind of, this is an example of a prisoner's dilemma. So your system goes quickly towards selfishness and no gain. So you have this thing called altruistic punishment. You get another round where you say, okay, now we know how much everybody put in, and you can donate $1 to take away $3 from somebody who didn't contribute. And when you do that, the people who are selfish quickly are punished, and they realize that selfishness is not a winning behavior, and you play the game repeatedly that way, and you converge on cooperation. And there's tons of examples of these institutions where that happens. There's another thing. You can even have a round where you're allowed to punish non-punishers. So, you know, I had the chance to punish a defector. I didn't do it. Then somebody could punish me. And when you do that, they've shown this mathematically, you very quickly can converge on altruistic behavior. And so my view is that we need to do this. We need to figure out ways to get people to behave altruistically. Breakthroughs in evolution are showing how it happens. These things have been very well tested by political scientists, by anthropologists. They even show that cooperating with others gives us more pleasure, more satisfaction than defecting. And we need to figure out how to do this and develop, and again, expanding the boundaries of group identity. So I think, you know, Israel is a great example of a country that's come together with puts the group ahead of the individual, group identity very, very strong. But the challenge is to expand that group identity to address the, you know, you guys are facing some existential challenges, but so are we at the global level when it comes to climate change and biodiversity loss and all these other things. So what we really need to do is, you know, when I look at a classic example of this is alternative energy, that if we, you know, our current system, fossil fuels, I burn that barrel of oil, you can't. We're competing for it. I can own it. My use doesn't leave any for you. We compete. It develops an economic system based on competition. Markets do that well. We're running out of fossil fuels, and we're running out of capacity for our ecosystem to absorb the waste. We need alternative energy. Alternative energy, no matter how much solar energy Israel captures, does not leave any less for any other country. So you can capture as much as you want. You're not competing with other countries for that. What we need to capture solar energy is better science, better information, technology. And you can privately own that with patents, but if you do develop that technology, prevent others from using it, you still suffer from climate change. On the other hand, if you develop that technology and you share it with everybody, it's going to come back better than it was. So a physical change in the characteristics of the resources required for our well-being. It's no longer this rival excludable resource that fits into a market. It's become a new type of resource that requires a new type of economic institutions. And that is what we need. And I have a lot of things there. These are, I want to jump over stuff, but there's a general rule in energy transitions that a struggle for energy causes violent conflict. My view is that a cooperation for energy, for the new types of resources, you once somebody helps out to do this, and you know, my view on this is that the rich countries should put in a pool of money to develop these technologies, make them freely available for all. That develops reciprocity and ends conflict and causes a new attitude towards things. So 4 minutes. All right. So really quickly, I am going to argue we need to develop institutions for cooperations. And we have these institutions that can make generous people act selfishly or selfish people act generously. This is just a list of publications, just a small list of publications that show simply studying mainstream economics makes people more selfish, less willing to help others, more willing to free ride. And you know, this is like, so this one's called Selection and Indoctrination. Why do economic students donate less than the rest? Economic professors also donate less than others. And it's an indoctrination process, we're told. And there's one, does studying economics inhibit cooperation? The answer is a compelling yes. Why are economists different? And it's the same thing. So many, many studies showing these outcomes, so that market economics seems to be an institution that deters cooperation, that incentivizes selfish behavior, that is exactly the wrong type of institution, and that these things about reciprocity, it's this the winning strategy in a thing for dealing with prisoners' dilemmas was called tit for tat. Somebody's good to you, you're good to them. Somebody's bad to you, you're bad to them. That was a winning strategy and a whole bunch of strategies for dealing with prisoners' dilemmas, reciprocate. What they found an even more winning strategy is reciprocate and apologize, reciprocate and forgive. Because sometimes people do the wrong thing accidentally. So reciprocity with forgiveness, you will never win a single round, but you will win the game. Reciprocity, this altruistic punishment is also very effective, and social norms. It used to be that if you, in hunter-gatherer societies, if you didn't share food with a community, you would be ostracized. And I am a huge proponent of resources that can't be individually owned, like the climate stability, the ozone layer. They should be commonly owned. And commonly owned means rights not only equal rights for this generation, but guaranteed inalienable rights for future generations, that you can't use more than, so if we, for example, we can't spew CO2 into the atmosphere faster than it can be absorbed because that would deprive future generations of climate stability. And I don't want to take too much time. I want to leave time for questions. So my basic case is there are very good institutions for creating commons. We have no alternative because you can't own things individually. Waste absorption capacity is a great place to start. So in Vermont, we've put forward a law that hasn't been passed into law yet, but it's called the Vermont Common Assets Trust. It says the atmosphere is a shared asset of all Vermonters now and in the future. And if there's a certain waste absorption capacity, so we're allowed to emit that much pollution because it's going to be absorbed. But if you emit it as an individual, you are taking from the commons. You're taking for your own use what belongs to the commons. You have to compensate the commons. And you can't take more than the system can sustain indefinitely. And we have this, so this is one of the things we're trying to do. I'm a huge proponent of common assets and green technologies. The rich countries start this thing. We're going to start funding the best scientists around the world to create green technologies. Everything is freely shared. That's going to maximize the benefits we get. Another huge thing, I think, is this redefining the group. We used to be hunter-gatherers, had a group of 150. Now we have nations. Israel's a nation of 8 million, where you define the group as that. United States, we define Americans as 300 million. You need to define the group at the scale necessary to address the problem. The problems we now face are global in scale. We don't know very well how to redefine the group. These are the tasks which we should be aiming towards. Mainstream economists want to internalize ecosystems into the market. Ecological economists say, let's internalize our market economy, or let's internalize our economy into the global ecosystem. It's a kind of a different way. And I think I'm like past my time now. So I was going to talk about some ways to and maybe I'll just end with this really fast instead of the other conclusions I have. There's this great systems thinker who said, Donella Meadows, who did Limits to Growth, worked on complex systems her whole life, said three leverage points for changing. Well, she said she gave 10. These are three of the most powerful. First, she said, change the paradigm. What is biophysically possible? The current paradigm of economists is the economy can grow forever as long as we manage to internalize the ecosystem into the economy. Don't need to worry about that. So it's this limitless expansion. Ecological economists say, no, we've got to totally flip that around. We've got to say the economy is the part, the ecosystem is the whole, the economy can't go without limits. It's as profound a paradigm change as saying going from the sun circling the earth circling the sun. So this changing the paradigm of what's biophysically possible and changing our understanding of human nature. We are intensely capable of cooperation, altruism, the things needed to solve these problems. Another thing she said is change the goals. Our current growth is never-ending economic growth, maximizing monetary value, selling that ton of wheat to the person who will pay the most, not to the person who most desperately needs it. So we've got to move from this values to sustainability, justice, and satisfying basic needs. And the third thing was to change the rules, which I interpret as the institutions. And what we need is economic institutions to say, what is it we want? What are the characteristics of the resources? Then how do we decide what institutions are appropriate? This is what I'm making the case, is that a lot of ecosystem functions and services, they have totally different characteristics than these things we can own, and my use leaves less for others. Information has totally different characteristics. So we want an economic system in which it's value-driven. We have certain goals we want to achieve, but it's based on science. I would argue that mainstream economics is based on ideology. We're told that whatever the problem is, the market's the best solution. Or if you're a Marxist, whatever the problem is, you know, Marxism's the best solution. We need a situation where you decide what is the nature of the problem. That determines what institutions are necessary. You can't have private ownership of a stable climate. There's maybe social ownership of the means of production. But other things, maybe we can. So we need to have a scientific approach to economics. So, you know, science-based, value-driven. And I had a ton more stuff, but that's too much already. So I'll cut it short there. And I hope I didn't talk too fast, and I hope I didn't jump over too many ideas so that it was kind of coherent. Have any questions? There's time.
So, please, let's open up. Do we have any questions?
Or critiques. I got a tough skin. You're perfectly welcome to reject any of the ideas, to challenge. I was trained as an economist, and they hate these ideas, so I'm used to it.
Sure. I'll give two questions. Right. Hopefully that'll open up. The first one is really it's an unorthodox question. What is it about Vermont which excuse our people and we have these odd ideas? So anyway, that one you don't have to answer. The second one, a little bit more serious, is so it seems to me that the thing which we're reaching for, the core thing, is if we define ourselves in groups, and for the last 250,000 years, even more potentially, we've been able to identify our own selfish good with the good of the group, and the one becomes subsumed under the other.
Yeah.
But in those traditional societies, it was always very, very much small scale.
Yep.
And one of the transitions which happens in the late 19th century socially is that we move from small scale society to large scale, where we're surrounded by people who we don't know.
Yeah.
And then that sort of transforms the interactions which we have. So the core mechanism again. What I want to ask you. So I know it's possible to cooperate. But the question is it possible to cooperate within the sort of abstracted large scale boundaries which we organize the nine sort of 7.2 billion people.
And this is the thing. So humans, genetically, it seems we have evolved to be able to have some kind of social connection with about 150 people, which is called Dunbar's number. Some anthropologist said this is the size of our evolving groups. It's the groups we evolved with. And But and so that's our genetic capacity. But we have a cultural capacity. You know, a lot of species depend on genetic evolution. We can use cultural evolution. And we have clearly developed these cultural mechanisms that redefine our group and typically redefine the group in to reflect the nature of the challenge we face. And, you know, for a long time, the size of groups has gotten larger and larger and larger. And again, what defines a group, so... And you can have different types of groups for different problems. You know, so my big thing I'd be pushing for right now if I was in power is just to start out is that the rich nations really do put huge amounts of resources into developing alternative energy technologies. And one thing I think is, okay, let's, you know, so Iran wants to develop nuclear power. Let's offer free scholarships to their best scientists to study, you know, alternative energy. There's nothing, no skills that transfer over there, deters them from having that. But then you share this ideas, and people do have a very strong sense of reciprocity. When somebody does something good to you, you want to do something good to them. And it's a challenge. And I'm not saying, you know, I really, you know, one of the things I had in a slide I didn't say is, you know, how naive and utopian is this? And my view on it is it's completely naive to think that we can solve these challenges through competitive self-interest. And it's completely naive to think we can continue with our current business as usual. And what we need to do is search for solutions that seem tailored to the characteristics of the problems and what we know about humans. And we have seen, you know, so people, you know, in the United States, we now identify our group for a lot of things as 300 million. You can get Americans to go sacrifice their lives to give up everything to defend that larger group. And so I think that, I don't know the answers exactly how to do it, but I think we have abundant evidence that we really have been, through cultural innovations and institutions and evolution, able to redefine our group in a larger and larger scale. Because the bad thing about this group selection is putting the group ahead of the individual is morally good, but you can do whatever you want to other groups. You can just kill them. You can, you know, that they're not human. And so... looking at this, even looking what they did in Great Britain when they got rid of slavery. So they decided they wanted a, you know, a small group decided, and I think like 1812 or so, they're going to get rid of, they wanted to fight against slavery. And we said, that's ridiculous. You know, nobody's opposed to slavery except the slaves, and they have no power. And here you are trying to take on the most powerful people and do this. And in 12 years, they did it, and they did it through empathy. They got people to identify with slaves as fellow people. And when you identify, when you see somebody as an individual with a family and relations like yours, it becomes very hard to cast them as other. And in war, obviously, we always try very, very hard to brand those people as the other. And I don't know the answers. What I'm trying to say is these are the directions we should look towards for solutions. So I don't know who two of you.
Do you think in order in order to get these changes, then some firm action needs to be taken, and someone has to take responsibility upon himself or the group upon themselves and do it. And it seems like something that could be very hard to achieve in the Western world in democracies, where people are free to choose, people can vote. Do you think that it is something that is possible in democracies? I mean, it sounds like, you know, the best way to achieve that would be not in a democracy where the whoever's in control has, you know, a firm grip on the population. And so the question is, in order to achieve these goals, would the population around the world or in the Western countries have to give up some of their most important values?
So strangely enough, so in mainstream economics, we define everybody as individuals. We're, you know, really, really individualistic, which I think is the most bizarre distortion of human nature imaginable, since I think an individual separate from society is arguably not even human. I mean, there's a great new book actually out called The Social Conquest of Earth, arguing that we are the most social and cooperative of all species, and that... this is an interesting thing because, you know, I'm very interested in evolution, that of a handful of times in evolutionary history, species have learned to cooperate at a level that selected at the group over the individual. Those species now account for 50% of animal biomass on the planet. So arguably, it's the most successful adaptation ever. And this idea that we're individualistic, do you know anybody who could actually survive on their own without the, you know, without society? You know, I think we are almost uniquely incapable of that among all species. We perpetrate this myth that we are individualistic. There is this problem with democracy because, you know, in the United States right now, most Americans don't believe in climate change. And so we democratically decide we're not going to do a damn thing about it. But I really do believe that we have most people, actually increasingly even in America, people are saying, we've got to get together and do something about climate change. And strangely enough, we have economists, and I think economists, mainstream economists, say the answer is always the market. So we invest almost nothing in alternative energy. Like the, you know, compared to, so energy sales, about 0.3% are invested in research and development for all types, including fracking and everything else. Samsung invests 20 times more than that in research and development. So we have decided that we've got to do more. Mainstream economists are saying, well, what we need to do is have really, really strictly enforced private property rights to information. So that if I develop this great new technology, nobody can use it for 20 years. And instead, what we need to do is an alternative way to look at things, say, gosh, you know, we've all these countries have pledged to give billions to helping poorer countries. Why don't we put that into, like, you know, a green technology common asset? And so, first of all, I think it's a total myth that we're intensely individualistic. I think we are the most cooperative species ever. Americans are notoriously consider themselves the most individualistic, but even us, I don't know anybody who can make it on their own. Don't know anybody. I know some really rugged individualistic types who hunt, forage for food and do all this. I don't know anybody who can make it on their own. So one thing I think we got to end that story, which I think is a fake story, and I think is kind of coming to an end. But economists are really, really tied to that methodological individualism. We only look at the individual. So, and the other thing, though, and maybe we'd have to sacrifice, let's say it was true, we had to sacrifice some of our values. I think bringing your kids to adulthood is a good value. And I think if we don't deal with climate change and these other things, that's a value we're going to have to sacrifice, too. And you had your hand up first.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you about the alternative to expansionist model where the Earth is not expanded upon, but the moon conquering would be a way to extract resources. The technology existed for 50 years, but never was developed. In other words, you can take all the resources from the moon, apply it to Earth, and nobody's going to complain on the moon. You can run it to zero.
Yeah. So there's this big talk that we can go to space, get resources from space. So there's two things here. One is the moon, you know, what we need right now is climate stability, protection from ozone layer, balancing atmospheric gases. The ecosystems are these intensely complex systems. We really don't understand how they function, prone to serious uncertainty. And we need to maintain intact those global ecosystems. If we're going to send, you know, ships to the moon to take its resources, there's a huge energy expenditure. We could build a space elevator that would have this thing that would reduce that. But it's still, you're bringing in huge amounts of new resources, and you're bringing in resources which our ecosystems have never had a chance to adapt to and learn to process. So, you know, natural wastes, our ecosystems have adapted to. It's the non-renewable resources that allows us to produce these chemicals like plastics that might take a million years to biodegrade, all sorts of waste that our ecosystems haven't adapted to. So first of all, there's this thermodynamic challenge of getting spaceships out there, getting the resources, and then bringing it back. And it takes a huge amount of energy to do that. And you know, these fossil fuels, we can burn up as fast as we want, but when they're gone, they're gone. I guess the way I look at it is I'm not willing to bet the future of humanity on technologies we don't yet have. And also this idea that we could just go colonize other planets. We have a mighty good planet right here. And I think it's a lot more reasonable and feasible to take care of the one we have than assume that we can, like, you know, tow Venus into orbit parallel the Earth around, you know, And when the thing with economic growth, I worked with a physicist who listened to economists. They said, we have economic growth at this rate, and this is what it needs to grow at, and it takes energy. So he calculated that in 1,000 years, we needed to build a Dyson sphere, where we would crush up the planets, develop a sphere around the sun that would capture 100% of solar energy. In 1,000 years, current economic growth rates will require that much energy. Some economists say we could do that on Earth, but that would make if we keep using energy that fast on Earth, even clean, affordable energy, it would make the surface of the Earth hotter than the surface of the sun, challenge to life. But Within 10,000 years, with economic growth at our current rate, we would need to capture the energy of the entire galaxy. I personally say let's try to have a degrowth economy. I think, and I didn't get into this, but I think we consume way too much that it makes us worse off in America. You know, people are really unhealthy, overweight, drive our cars everywhere. We're disconnected from community. They say the single unhappiest moment an average person's day is driving to work alone. And, you know, if you're taking the bus, you're talking to people. If you're riding your bike, you're getting exercise, and it's enjoyable. And I think we're sacrificing our well-being on this altar of consumption, just making ourselves miserably worse off. And no evidence that, you know, we've tripled our per capita consumption in the United States since 1960. So we know empirically what would be the costs of reducing our consumption by two-thirds. We know empirically we'd have to have a 1960 standard of living. You know, that's not misery and death and destruction. So we know we could achieve that, and but over that time, there's no evidence that we're any happier with life as a whole. You know, even in spite of all the antidepressants we're taking, there's no evidence that we're happier. So if, and as one of my friends said, if America, consuming 25% of the Earth's resources, had something to show for it, if we were the happiest people on the planet, if we just walked around with these huge smiles on our faces and we're elated, then you could say, well, then there's a justification for what we're doing. But we're not happier. We're less happier than Costa Ricans that consume one-fifth of what we do. So I think unless you have a really concrete evidence that the path we're doing is some amazing benefit, then maybe we could try to do it. But if there's no evidence of a benefit, why don't we just try to protect what's good and reduce our consumption? And I actually think that coming together as a group to address a common challenge. You know, my friend Michael was telling me that here in Israel, when there's an outside threat, Israelis come together, they get more friendly, they're kinder to each other, they're better to each other, they help each other. It's a good feeling. And I think we face an existential threat at a global level that we need to come together to solve, and that is can give us that deep, meaningful sense of life that we have.
Thanks very much. It was very thought-provoking. I know this wasn't really the major focus of your talk, but you did mention a couple of times the issue of population growth and that we can't let people have as many children as they want. I was wondering if you could just speak a little bit more specifically about what your ideas are about controlling population growth or what we need to do or how to do it.
So this is super challenging. First of all, I'd like to say, you know, if you read the New York Times, you'll frequently see articles saying, oh no, population growth is slowing down and that's gonna be a terrible economic burden. The most recent one they had was about Cuba. You know, Cuba, 11 million people on that little island, and they're saying it's a really desperate situation, their population growth is slowing down. A very widely respected economist, Julian Simon, said that our population can keep growing at the same rate for the next 7 billion years with current technologies. Somebody pointed out that would be more humans than there are atoms in the universe. He said, I meant 7 million years, but that would still be more humans than there are atoms in the universe. So my point is, exponential growth is impossible. We've got to slow it down. So one of the things that does seem to have worked very effectively is empowerment of women and giving women education and empowerment. On the other hand, my mom was a doctor, a medical doctor. Came from a very poor family, but like they supported her. She went, you know, her dad had an eighth grade education. She worked hard, became a doctor, amazing woman. I'm the fourth kid. So it's certainly not an infallible approach. I don't really know what is a good approach. There is no easy approach to population because, you know, the United Nations says it's a basic human right. One thing, one of the biggest demographic transitions in history was in Brazil, where my father-in-law is one of 11 kids who lived, or one of 10 kids who lived, I guess, and all my friends there have like one kid. And one, they had a National Geographic on it. There's this thing called the Sabido method, where they insert important messages into soap operas and television programs. And they did this in Brazil. And so one thing, and you watch Brazilian soap operas, they have very powerful, strong women with one or no kids. And so one idea is that this has empowered people to have fewer kids. Another is you have great soap operas on at night, so people do that instead of sex. It's the single most challenging thing we face. But I do think this idea that, you know, Garrett Hardin's Tragedy of the Commons was originally written about this, that, you know, if people have as many children as they want, you know, I love kids, man. It's the best thing I've ever done in my life is having kids. And I would love to have more kids, but I have to say, no, I can't because I'm imposing the costs on others. I it's the most difficult. One solution I think is kind of atrocious, but was once some ways proposed, give every woman the right to have two children. So reproduction is 2.1. Every woman has the right to have two, and then this was proposed by an economist, they can sell away parts of a right. So if you want to have more kids, you buy it from somebody who wants to have less. So one thing, it empowers poor women. So, you know, I'm poor, I can't really afford to have kids. I have a very valuable asset now. I can sell somebody who give me a lot of money for it. But, you know, this idea that we're trading children's lives is horrendous. But, you know, but in other ways, it's very democratic. It's very empowering. I'm not saying I'm in favor of it. I was just saying that that's one solution I'd read. You know, another thing, empowering and educating women, I think that's really great. But, you know, I'm the fourth kid of a doctor. So I don't know the answer.
I find it interesting, by the way, with relation to this question, that you don't comment on the Chinese
No, and I think
concept with relation to the democracy.
Yeah. And I do think, and they had, you know, people talk about how draconian it was, but, you know, you have this huge population, so they said one child, and you couldn't do it other ways. You could have, you know, economic penalties for more than one child. You know, your first kid, health care, education, second kid, nope, sorry. Quite most countries, it's the opposite, like in France and in a lot of, you know, and even the U.S., I get more kids I have, more tax breaks I get. So you can, and I do think one of the things that actually is surprisingly powerful and underused is social norms. So in Brazil now, the social norm is, you know, one child. And people are looked at a little funny when they're having more because people do seem to recognize there's too many kids. And that country's population growth just plunged. And people, you know, and part of it is, like, you're looked at a little selfish. If you have more than one kid, you're kind of looked at as a selfish person. So, but it's, you know, I mean, it is the most emotional, difficult, challenging question out there. So I have a few issues on this, because there's a couple different things. There's like payment for ecosystem services. One of the most common they talk about is carbon sequestration. And that if I pay Brazil to plant trees and sequester carbon, that allows me to spew more carbon. So first of all, I believe that our goal is to dramatically reduce emissions. So I think we could have some kind of, you know, fine or a cap and auction system for emissions. And then the money from that goes to pay for sequestration elsewhere. You know, I really think we need to do both. I don't believe in the notion of offsets. I don't believe that we can take geological carbon that's been stored for millions of years, spew it into the atmosphere, and then sequester a little carbon using trees, which is biological carbon with a much different cycle, and call that a fair trade. And I do agree that if we do that, it's going to cause real hardship. And this is one of the things, you know, even if we... So let's say we put a price on carbon. It's going to drive up the cost of carbon. That's going to drive up the cost of food. And actually, they've done this, where they put a price on carbon. Poor people use less. Rich people go on and do the same. So it's exceptionally unfair. But payments for ecosystem services, another big problem with this is there's these studies that show that if you pay somebody to do something they would willingly do for free or believe they have a moral compulsion to do, paying them changes their whole frame of mind and makes them less likely to do it. And they've done this. They've done a good article that came out on this in July on payments for ecosystem services. So you're working with these people who would know it's important to provide these ecological benefits, and they do it out of a social obligation. But then when you pay them to do it, suddenly it becomes a market transaction. So in the United States, when they started, some economists said, you know, we wanted to increase blood donations. They said, let's pay people to do it. And what happened when you paid people to do it, people would donate blood because it's a good thing to do. They wouldn't donate it for $10 unless they're drug addicts or alcoholics, and then they would. So what we saw was a decrease in blood supply and a decrease in quality when we started paying people. And there's a ton of literature on this now. They say that paying people, they've even done it with IQ tests. They get a bunch of students at a university, say we have 100 students here. As part of the study, we want you to do an IQ test. And the students will sit down and do the IQ test and look at the average IQ score that you'd expect for the university. They take another group and say, we'll give you 10 cents for every question you get right. Their IQs go down. And it's not that their IQs go down, it's not worth trying for 10 cents. And you changes your motivation. One motivation is, I want to be part of this study. I said I'd do it. I have a social obligation to do a good job because I said I would. The other one is, now it's a monetary thing. And this is a topic I go on a lot at length, but there's tons of studies showing that getting people to think about money makes them more egotistical, more likely to free ride, more likely to be corrupt, and that we have to be super careful with that. So we're trying to do payments for ecosystem services in Brazil, but through reciprocity. The government steps in, will help the farmers with the fences and the trees, and that protect the riparian zones, and the farmers get some benefits. So, you know, they put resources into it, the state puts resources into it, and the farmers then feel like they owe society because society's helped them, rather than it being a monetary transaction. But again, these are tough issues. And
short question.
For me, it seemed like your lecture was very humanistic. And you know, what if we measure and in the end we will find out that people are like that? Like, what I'm asking is, maybe it's better to have this humanistic ideology about human beings.
And well, so the way I phrase it is that so mainstream economists say markets are value neutral decision tools. And what they're really saying, though, is we should weight preferences by purchasing power, which is an intensely value-laden decision. So mainstream economists say that economics is value-neutral objective. I say that's absolute nonsense. You know, deciding that you're going to award resources to preferences weighting by purchasing power is not. So what I actually say is that economics has to be value-driven. We have certain goals that are humanistic. We have to decide what is desirable for society, is some kind of democratic, participatory discussion process, figure out what it is we want. Once we know what we want, and that's the humanistic ethical side, then we have to look very carefully. What are the characteristics of these resources? What is it we understand about human behavior? What is it we understand about the ability of culture to change human behavior and institutions to change human behavior? So we use our best science to decide, and again, this is the thing that, so if you have a fossil fuel economy, we're competing for it. It's a scarce resource. If we have an alternative energy society where knowledge is what's required, we're not competing for knowledge. Knowledge improves through use. So that's a scientific decision based on a careful analysis of the nature of the resource to decide what's the best way to allocate. And I, for whatever reason, economists tend to be extremely ideological. And they're like all, should we everything, social ownership of the means of production for everything, or free market capitalism, private property for everything. I actually think some resources have to be, collective actions the only way. Others, markets can work well depending on our goals. So it's really this idea that, and we have to understand ecosystems. So mainstream economists also assume away uncertainty. So there's this idea of risk. I know the possible outcomes and the probabilities of each. Uncertainty is, I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what the possibilities are. Couldn't possibly know the probabilities. We know that these uncertain outcomes are widespread in ecosystems. If we have a system that assumes those away, that's a defective system. And mainstream economics does assume those away. And, but it means we never know the answer. All we can do is try to move in the right direction, see how that, and treat every policy we do as a scientific experiment. That tells us, first of all, was the values underlying that technology, or was the values underlying that policy appropriate? Because a long time has been a value, maximize monetary value has been the goal. Maybe that's a bad goal. I think we should examine that, say that's a bad goal. We also have to decide whether the policy achieves the goal and whether ecosystems respond. So I think every policy has to be treated as a scientific experiment, testing both the desirability of the goals and the effectiveness of the policy, and whether or not the policy doing what we thought it would do has the broader repercussions we also thought. But yeah, so I am unabashedly say economics is a normative discipline. You know, it's about what we care about, what we value. But once we've decided on that, then it's got to use science to figure out how to get it. That would be my view. That's.
Well, thank you very much. I want to thank you for a great talk. Thank you.
And, sorry if I went a little over, didn't leave enough for questions, but.